Antinatalism is the view that it is wrong to bring sentient beings into existence. Although there are many varieties of antinatalism, ranging from environmental antinatalism, that due to our present or perceived environmental woes, it is wrong to have children, to a weak antinatalism, that existence isn't intrinsically wrong, but rather bad on average, and more. But in this video, I'll focus on the strong antinatalist claims made by authors like David Benatar that say that all sentient existence is fundamentally bad and that it is always unacceptable to create more of it. Let's start with some definitions. Sentience is the awareness of existence. So antinatalism claims that it is wrong to bring new beings which are aware of existence into existence because existence is fundamentally in some way tragic or evil. This rests on the philosophical presupposition of axiological asymmetry, that the absence of good things is not good or bad, it's morally neutral, but that absence of bad things is good. Therefore, there is no amount of pleasure that could justify the harm of bringing someone into existence if that could affect any pain within them. This, by the way, holds regardless of whether the individual perceives their life to be of positive or negative value. The potential for a positive outcome is certainly not bad, per se, but it's not good either. I want to present a video, an alternative view of axiological asymmetry, that life is, in fact, of positive value, not as contingent on the pleasure and pain of individuals, but rather there is some fundamental utility ferried out of human beings through their lives and destiny proportional with their accordance with the moral law and teleology of the universe. The Earth as a place for physical incarnation is a somewhat hostile and in some ways dangerous environment. Yet this is precisely why it is able to be of such high value. Let's start with a fundamental question. What is the purpose of reality? To answer this question, we must get back to fundamentals. There are two poles of existence, infinity and unity. On the one hand, you have the multiplicity of all of the various things which exist in reality. And yet in the codomain of that mapping, you have the identity of that system, the unity which holds together all of those infinities, the infinite source of existence. And in the domain, you have the way that the infinite expresses itself in the world. The infinite, by definition, is a paradox. It wants to create more of itself because there's no finite quantity which can contain it. And so it contains within itself the possibility of every finite process, object, and relation. So everything in existence in every possible terminal domain is the cross-definition of unity, the rules and structure of reality, and infinity, the particular objects, processes, and relations in reality as the expression of more of existence. Maimonides says that the creator, seeing that creation is good, desired that it to create more of existence. And this is everything that is possible to exist does exist. And Chris Langan says even more succinctly, existence everywhere is the will to exist. So everything in existence is this logical self-simulative scratch pad to compare the aggregate utilities of various self-configurations, in the words of Chris Langan, meaning it creates this veil of forgetting, locally confusing itself through cognitively bound observer participants with the illusion of finitude. And nevertheless, they are all projections. This is the cosmic joke of the same fundamental identity. So there's no ultimate separation. Therefore, through forgetting its identity in the form of these secondary images, reality can come to know itself in a more full and complete unity through the true and good order freely willed and created by its participants in the self-simulation, a multi-layered veil of illusion which allows us to exist and make choices in the world. So there's this primordial impulse to unity which underlies reality that we as human beings are meant to give this fallen world as a gift back to the creator. There's this ultimate logos of reality, the intelligent principle by which the one comes to see itself. Immediately from the undifferentiated potential emerges this primordial mind. For the interconnectivity of the mind of reality, there are all these sublogi, primary telic recursive parameters, operators which feed back between syntax and state, form and instance to generate the self-simulation, an intersubjective plane of existence within ultimate reality, which allows observer participants' free will to understand and realize that they are secondary images of the GOD, the global operator descriptor of existence and the essential basis of reality, and therefore that they are able to affect the structure and dynamics of reality in an advantageous way. In the self-simulation, the good, capital G, is so thoroughly masked that many have concluded that this is actually the worst of all possible worlds, perhaps the creation of Satan or one of his minions. But if you take everything into account from the Alpha to the Omega, this is the best of all possible worlds, because the greatest light can be found within the deepest darkness. The good willed within this world is worth more to God than a trillion of the heavenly host with no free will or volition. God wants to be found in the most mundane of places. Your essential basis lies not on this plane of existence, but rather the mapping that created you, called the mu morphic grammar in the CTMU, that connects God to his secondary images. This is your soul. Strange as it sounds to scientific materialism, prior to your birth, your soul chose to incarnate as a human being on Earth. In his conversations with Dolores Cannon, an author and pioneer in the field of past life regression, her and Chris Langan were of the same opinion that each of us chose to come here for a purpose that becomes our mission. If we can figure out and complete our metaphysical mission as individuals and as a society, we can make this the best of all possible worlds for ourselves and everyone living in it, pass through the great filter, rekindle the creative fire of mankind, intelligently organize around freedom, wisdom, and love, developmentally scale past the problems of war, poverty, corruption, evil, and more that plague mankind, and reunite with the cosmic logos, the knowledge of God over all creation as the waters fill the sea. The suffering inherent in human life and biological evolution is attempting to ferry value out of our lives. Yes, life is suffering. I agree here with the Buddhists, for instance. The level of violence and cruelty and evil which emerges in the world, both by humans but also in the natural world, is terrifying. Evil here is not only the malevolence intentionally inflicted on others, but also the tragic element of being. Yet this evil is not inherent within the structure of reality, but instead emergent, because reality has layers of self-generative freedom. Chris Langan says, free will exists, and good cannot exist without the potential for evil. There is no way to permanently exclude evil from reality. If the created world is the answer to the question, what happens if portions of reality are free to do whatever they want? For its self-identification, for the reality self-identification to identify with the true and good order created within reality to renew and fortify its identity, and these primal, freely willed self-identification events are the essential basis of reality, then in order for anything good to exist, so too must evil, or else there is nothing against which to compare it, or at least the possibility of evil. It is only relative to evil that good can emerge. This is the tragic fact of being. An evil contrasts with teleology, which Langan defines as the generic will of God, divine self-identification and self-existence, along with their reinforcement and refinement. Clearly, it is not intelligible to say that the extension of reality, the creation, is evil, because goodness consists of consistence with teleology and positive teleological reinforcement. And evil is anti-teleological thoughts, actions, and desires, negative teleological reinforcement. So to say existence is evil is a contradiction. Where the primary metaformal quanta is constantly willing itself into existence, it cannot be evil on that account. It can't be against existence. It can't be against the good. It is good. It is the good. It is the telos, the end and purpose of human beings to embrace this condition of human existence, of the malevolence and suffering of our lives, of the life of biological evolution, for example. This has existed, the trial or test, if you will, and nevertheless be who they ought to be. Life is an intelligence and morality test with a cosmic John Quinones before whom all must stand. What would you do? What did you do? When we define omnibenevolence as the self-reinforcement imperative of God, God defining goodness on the nature of God himself, by willing true and good order within reality and creating positive experiences for other tellers, we allow more of God to be expressed within existence. God is defining himself through creation on his lower orders of identity, human beings, other complex operators in reality, etc., endowing these with freedom and then allowing them to discover love and wisdom, the primary distortions of ultimate reality, to then offer those to offer creation as a gift back to reunite with God. In the words of Schelling, from the chalice of this realm of spirits foams forth to God his own infinitude. The important points are that we did, if identity is defined broadly enough, choose to be born. Our incarnation was with our consent in the non-terminal domain. And we chose this for a specific reason. Man is the one through whom God unites creation to himself. To give a being, a telor under normal circumstances, the opportunity to do this, as long as you're not cursing them to neglect, abuse, or debilitating genetic diseases or makeup, which are all ateleological, is a moral good. God is ferrying something out of us, an important aspect of which is righteous abhorrence and resistance to evil. Chris Langan writes, the problem of evil is ubiquitous, but it cannot triumph over a proper understanding of God and reality. The only solution for the problem of evil is to use our free will to guard against it and suppress it as best we can. Unfortunately, mankind now seems to have fallen under the sway of venal, sybaritic Pied Pipers who despise God, labor under the profound delusion that they can deny God's existence or separate God from reality, and pretend to fill the role of God in the mental and material domains, despite their moral and spiritual inversion. Now, whose fault is that? He says. Basically, we're supposed to work and live in the world and take the hits as they come while remaining wise, compassionate, altruistic, and empathetic, loving our neighbors as ourselves, loving God with all our hearts, with all our souls, and with all our minds and strength, and learning, teaching, and defending the truth as it is revealed to us. This does not mean to shy away from the evil or challenge of the world. Quite the opposite. One of the greatest writers ever to put ink to paper, Fyodor Dostoevsky, says, pain and suffering are always inevitable for a large intelligence and a deep heart. The really great men must, I think, have great sadness on earth. But that's okay. Life is tough. Get a helmet. Nobody said this would be easy or even fun. We're, of course, meant to enjoy reality and recognize it as a sacramental avatar, a divine blessing, which we receive every day. But suffering for teleology, the intrinsic good of reality, especially when intransigent evil has taken over the world in many ways, when the earth seems to be run by not God, but under the authority of something else entirely, it is a moral necessity. Dostoevsky also writes, there's only one thing that I dread, not to be worthy of my sufferings. Chris Langan says, blessed are those who suffer for teleology, for they pay its price in the name of all who benefit from it. Striving towards a goal is a self-justifying axiological asymmetry. For example, running a marathon includes more negative emotion than positive emotion. But the fact that you are striving towards a goal is why almost everyone who runs a marathon thinks it was worthwhile. In the same way, the process of reality ferries out meaning from the suffering of the righteous participant. Being unwilling to confront the universe and instead blame God for your suffering is not a sign of righteousness, but instead the exact opposite. Life is good. The axiom of faith defined in coupling with absolute knowledge is that if you forthrightly and honestly confront the universe and go through the hero's journey of teleological self-actualization, making your life a sacramental avatar, an image or an icon of God in the world, mediating between the known and the unknown for the fuller self-knowledge of God and to unite heaven and earth and creation back to God. This is the thing that Coronius Focus talked about. If you can do that and then enact that in the world, that is a creative force. It expands your species and your ability to interact with your universe. So instead of serving your own individual utility through what Langan describes as irresponsibility, laziness, ignorance, stupidity, cowardice, and moral degeneracy, you're serving the global utility, that which is valuable to mankind and ultimate reality. If you shrink before the task of being, that's a problem with you, not with being. This is evidenced by the fact that people who have gone through great periods of pain and suffering and prolonged, durations of negative emotion, most will still say that their existence to date was worth living. And it's a supreme example of philosophical adolescence to not understand that value is broader than pleasure and evil is broader than pain. So in short, you did choose to be born, you have responsibilities and duties for the way you live your life, you also have the blessing of existence, to be a participant in reality, which is the unfolding of God's infinity. To return to the place you started on your journey, but to know the terrain for the first time is our task in reality, to become the heroes in our own stories and the broader stories of existence. As Dr. Gina Langan, Chris Langan's wife and author of the Teleologic CTMU Living Substack writes, "Let us rejoice to have the privilege of shaping the future of mankind at this critical juncture in human and planetary evolution. Thank you. God bless. Let the light shine forth in the darkness. The peace of our Father in heaven be upon you." Like and subscribe. Peace.